Psalm 103, verse 2. The New Living Translation says, "Let all I am praise the Lord. May I never forget the good things God does for me." Repeat these words after me. Let all that I am praise the Lord. May I never forget the good things God does for me. I want you to put a smile on your face, and I want you to look at your neighbor and say, "Neighbor, oh neighbor, count your blessings." I want you to look to the other side of the room and somebody, put a smile on your face, say, "Neighbor, oh neighbor, I didn't come to bother you, didn't come to stir your Kool-Aid, but I recommend you count your blessings." Wonderful God, in Jesus' name, as we prepare our hearts now for the teaching, preaching of your word, God, we pray that your spirit will guide us as your word goes forth in power and authority to accomplish that for which it was sent. Wonderful God, I want to thank you right now for the greater one who lives within us. In your name, God, I pray that the Holy Ghost, who is the convictor, convincer, and persuader of truth, will reveal the truth about the power and integrity of your word to every listener. And God, we pray right now that your word will be health to our bodies, strength to our hearts, renewal to our minds. We give you thanks, we give you honor, we give you praise in Jesus' name. And all of God's folks said amen. God bless you, ushers. You may be seated. Count your blessings. Good morning, beloved. How are you doing? How are you really doing? Has depression been knocking at your front door? Did you mess around and let them in for an extended stay? How was your Thanksgiving? Did you purposely make yourself sick this holiday by celebrating your pity party because things were different this year? What's going on in your life? Have things changed? Was there an empty chair this year at the table? Have you in disappointment been drinking coffee and tea on a regular basis? Have you been starting your sentences with, "I know the Lord's been good, but"? What have you been connecting to the other side of the conjunction? Denise, let me see if I can think of a few. "But things were not the same. But I really miss the way things used to be. But it hurts so bad. But this really isn't a good time. But I just can't seem to get over it. But I can't seem to get used to it. But I'm trying to get there. But they promised they would never leave me." Look at your neighbor. Say, "Neighbor, count your blessings." Our union, our selected portion of the sacred text for examination, is housed in the fourth book of the collection of Psalms. Psalms presents God's claim upon the whole world, and it articulates God's will for justice, righteousness, and peace among all peoples and nations. Arguably the most loved book of the Hebrew Bible, Psalms is a rich and varied collection of poetry from the life of ancient Israel. The psalmists express a wide range of emotions and feelings: joy, sorrow, fear, relief, oppression, hurt, amazement, yearning, and betrayal. It is unclear, Mrs. Capers, as to the precise activity that birthed our text. Our text cannot be attributed to any particular event in Israel or Judah church. I just don't know up, Susan, why the Psalter writes what the Psalter writes. However, when I performed an exegetical biopsy of the text, I discovered that the Psalter had engaged in dialogue with himself. In other words, the Psalter was preaching to himself. With no other historical information to work with, I began to do my own exegetical investigation, hoping to uncover some type of evidence that would unlock the biblical door. Well, actor, it is clear that the Psalter categorizes the blessings that the Psalter had experienced. But could it be that the Psalter was shaking himself out of depression? Could it be that the Psalter was going through medical hell, physical hell, financial hell, domestic hell, church folk hell? Could it be that the Psalter was on the verge of getting deeper into his own pity party? Could it be that nothing was going according to plan? Mrs. Hubbard, could it be that the Psalter got denied disability for the third straight time? Dr. Cheryl, could it be that the Psalter just buried a loved one? Could it be that the Psalter had been rejected? Ms. Moran, could it be that the Psalter's business venture was becoming a little raggedy? Could it be that the Psalter had used up all of his sick time and was at the end of his rope? Could it be that the Psalter was knee-deep in his sorrows? Could it be that the Psalter was just shot out and could not see the light of day? Dr. Houston, could it be that everything that could go wrong had gone wrong? Could it be, Mother Vincent, that the Psalter felt himself sinking into a depression that could have resulted in suicide? Could it be, Dr. Amica, that the Psalter could not get to church, could not get anybody on the phone, so the Psalter sat at his dining room table and began to think of what the Lord had done that he had never given God credit for doing? Could it be that the Psalter had defined his praise? What his praise was buried beneath a boatload of worries and trouble? Was his praise paralyzed by his problems? So many times, Mrs. Hubbard, in our lives, we get caught up in our circumstances that we never give God credit for the benefit of God in our lives. The Psalter shakes himself and says, "Let all that I am praise the Lord," or "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless God's holy name." The Psalter perhaps creeps up on something prophetic by inadvertently suggesting that praise takes preparation. Look at your neighbor. Say, "Neighbor, praise takes preparation." If the Psalter stirred himself up to give honest and authentic praise to Yahweh, then it raises the question of whether or not we insult God with our modest, formal, and lifeless praise. Maybe our praise ought to exemplify the good that God does in our lives. Beloved, don't allow your praise to take a back seat to your problems. The Psalter began, Brother Hoyt, to count his blessings, because the Psalter realized that had it not been for the Lord on my side, maybe you better count your blessings. And the Psalter gives us several prophetic reflections as to why we should count our blessings. Y'all ready to get on the train? I'm ready to go. First of all, I suggest that you reflect, Brother Billingsley, on your forgiveness. Look at your neighbor. Say, "Neighbor," or "Neighbor, God forgives. You see, the Psalter said, the first piece that I want to reflect on is God's forgiveness of my sins. Look at verse 12 on the trip. It says, as far as the east is from the west, so far God removes our transgressions from us. Beloved, while you are sipping tea with depression, you might want to reflect on the fact that God forgives sin. One New Testament writer, Brother Card, teaches us that we have all, somebody say all, we have all sinned and come short of the glory of God. Another New Testament writer teaches us in 1 John chapter 1 and verse 9, if we confess our sins, God is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. I want to tell you today that sin is bold. Did you hear what I said? Sin is bold. Sin will put a smile on its face and offer you a glass filled with poison. Sin is unashamed. It's unashamed of its greedy hands, its vile temptations, its jealous eyes, its vicious tongue, its deceitful manipulations. But God, somebody shout, but God. But God forgives us all our stuff. Somebody say, all my stuff. Somebody ought to turn their sour moment into a moment of rejoicing, because God said, I forgive you. And I want to thank God right now. Thank God for not holding my stuff over my head. I want to thank God for not reminding me of my sins. God, a few of us who are present here today, we just want to thank you that every time we try to take a step forward, you are not in our ear reminding us of what we did yesterday. God wants to push you forward and not hold you back. So I can see, Missy E, I can see the Psalter sitting at the table with depression, sipping on a cup of coffee, and he began to think about God that's forgiven my sins. God, all the stuff that has gone on in my life, God just looked past all that stuff, and he began to sip another tip of coffee, and he thought about not only the forgiveness of his sins, but he thought about his healing. Look at your neighbor right now and say, neighbor or neighbor, you need to reflect on your healing. You see, after God forgave the Psalter, Mrs. Hubbard, then God started repairing and rebuilding the Psalter. Look at your neighbor now and say, neighbor or neighbor, God is repairing and rebuilding you right now. Oh, baby, you should be reflecting on your hearing, your healing, because God has been working on you. God is rebuilding you. God has been repairing you. God has healed you from the terror of your own mistakes. God is a healer. Somebody say, God is a healer. Isaiah 53 and 5 says, but he was wounded for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the punishment that made us whole, and by his bruises we are healed. Somebody say, I'm healed. Somebody shout it again, I'm healed. You see, child of God, you need to be healed right now in Jesus' name. Be healed of your past. Be healed of your pain. Be healed of your sin. Be healed of your mistakes. Be healed of your loss. Be healed of your abandonment. Be healed of your abuse. Be healed of your sickness. Be healed of your fear. Be healed and be set free. Look at your neighbor right now disappointment began to roll his ugly eyes. Because disappointment thought he had the Psalter on lockdown. And I can see the Psalter when he began to reflect on the forgiveness of God. Then he began to think about, now I'm healed. I'm healed. I'm whole. Then he thought about, I've been redeemed. Look at your neighbor. Say, neighbor. Oh, neighbor. You've been redeemed. Oh, I suspect, Brother Hubbard, that the Psalter was starting to upset depression. I suspect that the Psalter looked depression in the eye, put the cup of coffee down, and pushed back from the table and told depression that he was redeemed. Now, I suspect that upon reflection of his life, he began to think about where he used to be, Miss Floyd, and how he used to be, Miss Floyd, and Miss E. Joy Bells begin to ring in his soul because he is not what he used to be. He's not there anymore. Somebody look at your neighbor real quick. Look at him and tell your neighbor, say, neighbor, oh neighbor, that person that I used to be doesn't live here anymore. You see, I've been redeemed. I've been redeemed, Kale. Psalms 111 verse 9 says God sent redemption to God's people. God has commanded God's covenant forever. Psalms 40, 1 and 2 says, I waited patiently for the Lord, and he inclined to me and heard my cry. God drew me up from the desolate pit, out of the miry ball, and set my feet upon a rock, making my step secure. You might as well be honest. You might as well stop lying about it, Sandra. You might as well just get it all out your system, because there's been some pit living around here. You see, your career was in the pit. Your relationship was in the pit. Your marriage was in the pit. Your credit score was in the pit. Your mind was in the pit. Your financial forecast was gloomy. Your living was sinking in the bottom of the pit of hell. Our country is in the pit of shame right now. But oh God, somebody shout, oh God. Oh God redeems. And I'm a witness that God is a redeemer. I am redeemed, bought with a price. Jesus has changed my whole life. If anybody asked you just who I am,